So it's my pleasure to introduce Paula García, who is a PhD student in QUINFOG, working on the broad field of quantum numerical analysis. You know that Paula did the master's thesis in Bilbao, in the famous group there with Mikkel on different methods for quantum computing. And now she's come to our group to work on algorithms for quantum computers and also quantum-inspiring algorithms for many fields, including partial differential equations. So please, Paula, enlighten us.
Thank you so much. I'm glad to be here to present our research on solving partial differential equations in quantum computer. It was done in collaboration with Javier Rodriguez Mediavilla and yourself, Juan José García Ripoll. Here you have the archive link in case you want to check it out. Before going into the presentation, I would like to talk about the outline that I will follow through it. First, I will introduce the broad field of quantum numerical analysis, which our work belongs to. But I will focus on methods to solve differential equations using quantum computers and also its suitability for current and near-term quantum devices. After that, I will move on to the presentation of the algorithm that we have developed, the variational quantum PDE solver. In the section, I will start by presenting its fundamentals, and after that, I will delve into the explanation of the theory behind it. Then we will be ready to understand the results obtained for the different simulations in which we implement this algorithm. We are going to use two benchmark equations, the one-dimensional quantum harmonic oscillator and the transmon qubit. We will not only focus on the ideal case, but we will also test the performance of our algorithm under noisy circumstances. As I have said, as current quantum computers are affected by noise, so we will test the suitability for our approach for current NIST quantum computers. After that, I will draw the conclusions from this project and also outline the future work. First, let us start with quantum numerical analysis, which is a field of quantum computing that has experienced one of the greatest developments in terms of the creation of quantum algorithms. Here we can see different applications in which the quantum computers assist in the resolutions of problems such as linear and nonlinear equations, systems of equations, or differential equations. One of the turning points in this area was the development of the HHL algorithm for solving systems of equations. With this algorithm, an exponential quantum speed was achieved with respect to classical algorithms for the same task. However, this algorithm is not only suitable for this resolution of systems of equations, but it can also be implemented for solving differential equations, as they can be written in the form of a system of linear equations. So the appearance of this HHL algorithm, together with the combination with the Euler method and quantum simulation, led to the development of techniques for solving ordinary differential equations using quantum computers. Since then, a great deal of effort has been put into the development of this technique, and it has led to an increase in the precision and also to an extension to another task such as partial differential equations. Some of the examples of the application of this kind of algorithm are the resolution of the heat equation or the wave equation. However, there is a problem with these techniques that are based in the HHL algorithm. Again, the problem is in the HHL algorithm itself also, and it is that these are fault-tolerant algorithms and hence not suitable for the current noisy intermediate scale quantum era, the NISQ era. Why? Because nowadays we have quantum computers, but these quantum computers are subject to a series of limitations, such as the small number of qubits, the noise sources that affect the application of the quantum operations, the lack of error correction, or also the limited access to the computers due to the cloud-based access. Therefore, these HHL-based algorithms are not suitable due to the higher demand in the number of qubits and operations. Nevertheless, we can find a solution for implement this quantum numerical analysis in the current NIST era and for solving partial differential equation, that is our goal, and it is to use an alternative approach. one of the most famous and used ones is the implementation of variational hybrid quantum classical algorithms, because these algorithms have shown noise resilience and also have lower hardware requirements, which made them suitable for the current NISQ era. These algorithms, as we can see in this scheme, have two components. It is a quantum computer and a classical computer, and they combine them both in order to solve a certain problem. The quantum computer performs the state preparation, that it encodes the solution of the problem in the form of a quantum circuit, and then this result, this quantum circuit, is measured. The result from these measurements are given to the classical computer, and it performs a classical optimization in order to update the parameters of this quantum circuit, and this is repeated until convergence. And finally, we will have the solution of the problem that we want to solve encoded in the state of the quantum computer. There are many examples of these quantum classical algorithms, and one of them is the variational quantum eigensolver. This is the most famous application, and it is used to obtain the ground state energy and ground state function of a certain quantum system whose Hamiltonian is known. Within these type of algorithms, our aim is to develop a variational hybrid quantum classical algorithm suitable for the resolution of PDEs, or partial differential equations. And how are we going to do that? We are going to use an ansatz that is space efficient and that measures structured quantum circuits for coarse graining together with Fourier-based interpolation. Now we are ready to explain this algorithm that we have developed, the variational quantum PDE solver. In this section, I will start by outlining the ingredients of these algorithms, as well as the challenges that we had to face in order to develop. After that, we will delve into the theory that is behind this implementation. The first thing is to make clear which kind of partial differential equations are we going to solve. And you can see this in this expression. These are partial differential equations with this form, in which the solution is a continuous function defined over a regular domain in which this function is periodic, bandwidth limited, and also tends to zero on the boundaries of the interval of definition. Moreover, we will have two types of operators defined in momentum and position space, as we can see here, V and D, and they have to be real. If we meet these requirements, we can assume that the PDE is a lower bounded Hamiltonian operator of this form. And now what we do is to seek the lowest energy, this minimum energy, and it corresponds to the solution, to the of the ground state, where that is the function that minimizes this expression. So it has the parameters so that we obtain this minimum energy, and this is the solution of the PDE. So what we have done is to transform our partial differential equation using a variational formalism that is now suitable for its resolution using a variational algorithm, such as the variational quantum PDE solver that we have developed. And these are the ingredients of our algorithm. So we can see here the general scheme, and I'm going to explain it step by step. The first one is the state preparation. As I have said, the solution is going to be encoded in the form of a quantum circuit, but this solution is a continuous function and the quantum circuit is discretized. So we have to find a way to map the continuous function to a n-qubit quantum register. So this is going to be the first challenge to face. We will have the momentum and position space, as we are working with these two kinds of operators. And we are not going only to focus on this position map, but also the momentum using the quantum Fourier transform, and also Fourier interpolation to reproduce the continuous function from the discretized register. After that, we will also have to find the quantum circuit that encodes this function using different variational ansatz. Once this map has been found, we are ready to measure the expectation values of the operators of the differential equation. And for doing this, we will again resort to the map between the position and momentum space and this discretization. Once this is ready, we move on to the classical computer, in which we estimate the energy associated to the function encoded in the quantum circuit. And here is another limitation or task to challenge. It is that I have said not compute the energy, but estimate the energy. And that is because we cannot have an infinite number of measurements, so we can compute the exact energy, but a finite one. This is going to be a limitation because here the energy is a randomized estimator and it's going to be has associated and a statistical uncertainty that is intrinsic to this method. After that, this energy is going to be as the cost function of the classical optimizer, and we will use it to update the parameters of the quantum circuit. After several iterations, we achieve convergence, and finally, for these optimum parameters, we have the solution of the PDE encoded in the quantum circuit. So that was the general explanation of the algorithm, and now I'm going to explain part by part how do we achieve it. So the first step is to learn to work with functions in a quantum computer, because the solution, as I have said, is a continuous function. And in order to map it into a n-qubit quantum state, we are going to discretize the position space using this expression into 2^n points, which is equal to the number of states in an n-qubit quantum register. By doing this, using this expression and this spacing for the position values in the position grid, we can store the evaluation of the function in for each of the points in this discretization on the amplitudes of the n-qubit quantum state. And if we normalize it, we already have the discretized version of the continuous function encoded in a quantum state. When it comes to the momentum space, the procedure is really similar. But now there is just one difference, and it is the way that the quasi-momenta are discretized. This is because in the Fourier transform, there is an anomalous ordering of the quasi-momenta in which the negative frequencies are stored in the higher values of the quantum register. So we have to use this expression. But besides this, everything is just the same. Here, we use the Fourier transform function and encode it in the amplitudes. And again, it would be equal to just applying the quantum Fourier transform to the state previously discretized. However, what we have now is that after using our algorithm, what we obtain is a discretized solution, and we are interested in the continuous function that is the solution of the PDE. So we have to find a way to approximate it. And the form to do that is to use position space Fourier interpolation. In this case, what we're going to obtain is this function, which is an infinitely differentiable continuous function, and we obtain it from the discretized momentum state. This is possible because we have two things, a small spacing in the grid and also a bandwidth limited function. Let us see why this is so important. The procedure for interpolation is the following. Here you have the discretized function in position space, so you can see the points that we have for the discretization. Now we go to the momentum space by applying the Fourier transform. And in this space, what happens is that we have a bandwidth limited function. So it means that if we go outside of the interval in momentum, so over here, the value of the function of the Fourier transform is zero. So we can add as many zeros as we want, and this is not going to affect this value. And while doing this, we move on to the next figure in which we have much more points and we have extended the momentum space. If now we go back to position space by applying the inverse Fourier transform, what we have is that the function that is defined in the same interval has no finer read because the spacing has been diminished by this addition of zeros. So we can interpolate the continuous function from this discretized approximation if we have a sufficiently high number of points. Here we have the quantum circuit that can be done to use this in a quantum computer, and it is the same that I have said. We have here the discretized quantum state encoded in this n-qubit register, and we apply the quantum Fourier transform. Then we add an n-qubit register and use these c-nodes due to the anomalous ordering of the quasi-momenta. After this is reordered, we can just apply the inverse Fourier transform or the whole new register, and what we have is now in the position space the discretized solution for n plus n qubits. So now we have everything necessary to talk about the computation of the expectation values, because we have obtained the map required for this in between this continuous space and the discretization. Now what we have to do is to find this quantum representation of the differential operator for the PDE. It is composed of two operators. The first one in position space, which is in it is has the following immediate discretization and application, and the second one in the momentum space. In fact, this operator is the one that contains the derivative, but we are going to use the representation in momentum space in order to perform the derivative in this space. And what we do is to first apply the Fourier transform. So we are in momentum space, and we can apply the momentum space representation of the operator. And then we go back to the position space by applying the inverse Fourier transform. If we do that, the result of the application of the two operators is going to be a function in the position space, and we can perform the optimization with this representation. Now, there is one ingredient left if we want to compute the expectation value, and it is the state. We are going to use a family of trial states, or ansatz, that is of the following form. So these are variational circuits that depend on a certain parameter. After knowing its form, we can compute the cost function, that is the expectation value, of our Hamiltonian, that is the differential operator. As I have said, we are not exactly computing it, but estimating it. And here we have that as we are adding two random variables, we have this intrinsic error, that is the statistical uncertainty of the order of 1 over the square root of m, where m is the number of measurements. Therefore, this is going to limit the performance of the algorithms, and the more measurements we have, the closer we are with this to this infinite limit of measurements, the ideal one, and the better are the results of the energy. As I have said, we have to figure out which kind of variational quantum circuits are the ones that we are going to use as ansatz for our variational quantum PDE solver. As a baseline, we use the RY ansatz that is really used in many applications in this kind of variational methods, and it is composed of layers of RY rotations and layers of C nodes. For the first kind of layer, the one of RY rotations, we have that they include the parameters, the variational parameters, because the RY is a quantum gate that depends on a certain angle. Moreover, it is a real value transformation, so we expect so the result arising from this application of the quantum circuit is going to be a real quantum state. When it comes to the entangling gates, we have a series of C nodes, and in this case we have chosen full entanglement, although we will have chosen another one, but we thought that it was the better option to have more flexibility to obtain the solution of the PDE. Another thing worth pointing out is that in this case what we have is a linear scaling of the number of parameters with the number of qubits. However, we also introduce another second ansatz because we aim to reproduce continuous function in a quantum register. And in order to do that, we have to find a way to design a variational circuit that is suitable for reproducing these smooth and highly differentiable functions. What we do is to define this ansatz that we have called the setGR, and that it is inspired in the one proposed by Salka, Grover, and Rudolph to encode non-negative probability distributions in a quantum circuit. It is composed of a series of conditional rotations that go from the most significant to the least significant qubit. The drawback of this approach is that now the scaling of the number of parameters with the number of qubits is exponential. However, we will still resort to it because it is more accurate than the RY ansatz, and therefore we expect it to push the limits of the variational method, reaching solutions that are really close to the ideal ones. Nevertheless, we have a way to reduce this number of parameters that may be a problem as the number of qubits increases, and it is the symmetrization of variational circuits. It consists of embedding the symmetries of the function in the variational circuit, and it can be done if the solution has the following two requirements. First, reflection symmetry, and second, asymmetric position space discretization. So we just change the expression for the discretization of the spatial variable into this one. And by doing this, we can apply the following quantum circuit for the symmetrization. It does the following thing. First, we have the function encoded in the n minus one least significant qubit that represents the positive part of the interval. So that goes from 0 to L over 2, where L is the position space interval, its length. At the same time, we apply a Hadamard gate on the most significant qubits, and it makes this qubit to be in superposition. After doing this, we just apply a series of C nodes and an X gate so that we can reproduce the values of the function in this added space. So at the end of this operation, what we have is that for the lowest states of the register, the symmetric part of the function is reproduced for the negative part of the interval, and on the higher states, the one for which this qubit is in the one state, we have the positive part. If we would want to have an asymmetric function, we would just have to apply this set gate. What we have done here is that now we have reproduced with n qubits a symmetric function, but the number of parameters that we have used to do that are the ones corresponding to the ansatz with n minus one qubits. So we have reduced the number of parameters, and that is very advantageous. Now we have finished to explaining all the theory regarding this approach, the variational quantum PD solver, and we are ready to implement it. In order to do that, we are going to use two benchmark equations, and that were very interesting. The quantum harmonic oscillator for dimension one and the transmon qubit. These two equations have an analytical solution that is smooth and easily differentiable. But there is a difference in the boundary conditions of these two equations, so the study of both of them is going to be interesting. For the first one, for the harmonic oscillator, we can see that this is the corresponding Schrödinger equation, and if we have mass, frequency, and h are equal to 1, the solution is now a trivial Gaussian, so this is the corresponding ground state. This is good for us because the Gaussian is an even, symmetric, and real function, and hence it is well suited to be reproduced with the ansatz previously described. So we can use the harmonic oscillator as a good test equation for our algorithm. Here you have this form of the Gaussian, and another important detail is that for the harmonic oscillator, and according to the Nyquist-Shannon theorem, we can modify the length of the position interval to maximize the accuracy in both position and momentum space. So we are going to obtain better results if we make this of this form, that it depends on the number of qubits. Now, we will also have another second equation, that is the transmon qubit. And in this case, we have the following Schrödinger equation, in which Ec is the energy of the capacitor, and Ej is the energy of the Josephson junction. In this case, the solution is the zeroth order solution of the Maxwell equation, which is the following one. And here you have its form for a ratio equal to 50, which is a common one for the transmon qubit. In fact, if we have this ratio and we expand this Hamiltonian around phi equal to zero, what we obtain is that the Hamiltonian of the transmon qubit can be approximated by the one of the harmonic oscillator, and therefore the solution can also be approximated by a Gaussian, leading to good results for the implementation of our algorithm, as the Gaussian is a good option for the ansatz described. However, in this case, it is an approximation, and this is not exact, because it fails to capture the nonlinear contributions, and not only that, but also it does not take into account the periodicity in the description of the transform. Here we can see that this periodicity of the independent variable of the transmon leads to the fixed momentum, sorry, position interval, and we can maximize the accuracy by modifying it. So what we are going to have here is expected worse results due to this limitation. Nevertheless, we still find that the transmon qubit is a very important equation because it is physically motivated. And indeed, what we are doing is something very interesting because we are using a quantum computer to compute the Schrödinger equations or to solve it for the components of a quantum computer, which are the transmon qubits. Once we know which two differential equations we are going to solve, we have to set which parameters or variables are we going to study. First, we have the solution for a different number of qubits, from 2 to 6, and also 3 different ansatz, the set GR and the RY with depths 1 and 2. When it comes to the classical optimizers, we will also suit the one that has, we'll look for the one that is most robust. And the differences between them are mainly how they estimate the gradient. In this case, for the Covilha, we have a gradient free method. For the SPSA, we use an approximate numerical gradient, and for the ADAM, it's an analytic estimate of the exact gradient. Another parameter to study is here, and it is the number of evaluations, because as we have said from the theory, we expect that the more evaluations, the better the estimation of the energy, and we want to see how this limits our algorithm. In general, we will use this number of evaluations, but we will also, for the simulations, but we will also see what happens if we increase it in a factor 4 in this case. Last but not least, it is also important to set what are the conditions for the simulation, because we're not only going to perform the ideal case, but we are also going to study how noise sources affect the results given by our algorithm in order to determine its suitability for the current NIST devices. I would also like to mention that for both simulations, for the ideal and noisy ones, we are going to use the QIS library provided by IBM. Before showing you the results, it is important to set which figures of merit are we going to use for the comparisons of them. We have focused on 2 different metrics, the determination of the precision in the estimation of the solution, and also the determination in the precision of the computation of the energy. For the first one, we are going to use what we have called the continuous fidelity. And it is a modified version of the fidelity. That is a figure of merit used for comparing the similarities of 2 quantum states, and if they are equal, it is equal to 1. In this case, the continuous fidelity compares, on the one hand, the discretization of the continuous function for n plus n qubits, and on the other hand, the n qubit optimized state interpolated up to n plus m qubits. If we have a sufficiently high m or large m, we can get closer to the infinite limit in which we have that is proportional to this integral. This figure of merit is very important because we are obtaining from the n qubit discretization how much information from the continuous function we can recover. In reality, for the practical implementation, we have chosen a number of qubits m plus m equal to 12, which already gives us good converged measures. Another thing to take into account when studying these simulations is that our approach, as it uses a quantum computer, is intrinsically stochastic, and we need to repeat the simulations a certain number of times in order to have enough statistics. This number of times that we have chosen is 100, and what we will plot is the median continuous infidelity, where the infidelity is 1 minus the fidelity, and also with error bars that are the standard deviation around the mean. Now, as I have said, we are not only interested in the solution that we obtain, but also in the properties of this solution. And for that, we have used another second figure of merit, in this case, the relative error in the computation of the energy, epsilon. This is an adimensional variable, and it is adapted to the energy scales of our problems. As we can see, it is divided by the difference in the theoretical energy of the first excited state and the ground state. Here we also have in the numerator the difference between the theoretical energy for the n-qubit discretization and the n-qubit optimized energy. These are the two figures of merit that we are going to use, and theoretically we will expect them to be proportional, but we will see that when it comes to the implementation of a quantum computer, it is not always the case. Now I'm going to show you the results, and we will start by the ideal studies. First, the harmonic oscillator. Now you can see two rows. In the first one, we have the results for always in these plots for 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 qubits. Here the continuous infidelity, and in the second row, the mean error in the estimation of the energy. What we can observe is that the best performance is achieved for the ADAM and SPA simulators. So first the ADAM and closely followed by this one. The reason is that they have a good tolerance to the stochasticity of our algorithm, but we can observe that if there is a difference between them, even if we use the same ansatz. This is because I have previously said they use a different technique to estimate the gradient. In the case of the ADAM optimizer, it is an analytic estimate of the cost function gradient, while the SPSA resorts to a stochastic estimate of this gradient. And in this case, it has errors that are increased with small denominators. So that is the reason that the SPSA has a worse performance. We are also interested in determining which is the most suitable ansatz for our approach, and in order to do that, what we do is to plot the best result of each ansatz independent of the lee of the optimizer. So now what we have here is that the blue line is the one that reaches a lowest infidelity, and it corresponds to the ZGR ansatz. So this is the one that shows a better performance. In fact, for the RY ansatz, we can observe here that for 3 qubits, more than 3 qubits, it gets trapped on local minima and the fidelity decreases. Why does it happen? Well, the reason is in the way that these two variational quantum circuits are constructed. When it comes to the ZGR ansatz, we have that it is designed to reproduce continuous functions in a quantum register, and the rotations are built on top of the previous ones in a smooth and easily differentiable way, so there is no loss of information. When it comes to the RY ansatz, it is different because it constructs the circuits so in a dense way that leads to loss of information, as the entangling unitaries are not capable of efficiently transporting it. And the result, the diminishing of gradients and a chaotic nature that is more present as more number of qubits and hence a greater number of parameters is shown in the circuits. Nevertheless, we obtain low infidelities, which is of order 10 to the minus 3 or 10 to the minus 5, despite the statistical uncertainty in the evaluation of the cost function that we have theoretically seen. And in order to study this, we will have this plot or this figure, and we have the stochastic path of the optimization. This is for a concrete case. In this case, for 3 qubits, the ZGR ansatz at the ADAM optimizer. But this behavior is expected to be obtained in similar ones. So now what we can see here is the statistical uncertainty that is of the order of 10 to the minus 2. And if we go back to the previous slide, we can see that the error in the computation of the energy for 3 qubits was of the order of 10 to the minus 3, which is well below this statistical uncertainty. In addition, if we plot the corresponding solution that for 3 qubits has only 8 points, we are capable of reproducing the theoretical continuous solution of the PDE with a very low infidelity. So that is a very good result. In fact, here we can see how good it fits. And here it does not fit so well, but the reason are the Gibbs oscillations. And if we have a look at the magnitude of these values, they are very small, and we expect they have a small contribution to the infidelity. Finally, for the study of the ideal harmonic oscillator, we analyze the increase of the number of evaluations. As I have said, we increase by a factor of 4 the number of shots, and what we obtain is that now the error on the computation of the energy decreases in a factor 2 as expected due to the order of the 1 over the square root of the number of measurements. What we can conclude from here is that the precision of the algorithm is limited by this number of evaluations, and the more evaluations we have, the better is the estimation of the energy. This also affects the reproduction of this solution of the PDE, as we can see here, because for a greater number of measurements, the fidelity also increases. Once we have done the study for the harmonic oscillator, we move on to the second benchmark equation, that is the transmon qubit. And in this case, we have the same figure that at the beginning of the study of the harmonic oscillator. And what we can observe is that, again, the Adam optimizer together with the set GR ansatz are the best option for implementing our algorithm. Therefore, what these results do is to confirm the observations done for the harmonic oscillator. However, there is a difference between the results of the harmonic oscillator and the transmon qubit, and this difference is that these are the ones of the transmon qubits are worse than the ones of the harmonic oscillator. There are the reason is that when it comes to the solution, which is the third order solution of the Mathieu equation, this is more complicated to reproduce than the Gaussian function of the harmonic oscillator. And it does not strictly vanish on the boundaries of the interval. This, together with the fact that we cannot increase or decrease the interval in position space to maximize the accuracy, leads to worse results for the transmon qubit. Now we have finished the ideal study, because until now we have focused just on how our algorithm performs under ideal circumstances. But now we're going to move on to the application to niche devices. These variational methods had the motivation to be implemented in these noisy niche devices, in which the qubit has a finite lifetime and the application of the quantum gates is imperfect. But even for imperfect variational constructs, it is possible to optimize them to reach the ideal or exact results. How are we going to do that? Well, now we are going to test the suitability for our algorithm for these devices by using a simulator of one of these computers. And it is the IBM Q Santiago provided by the IBM Q Experience. It has the following characteristics: a coupling map that is linear, and these are the 5 qubits that comprise the computer, these basis gates, and the following noise model that is composed of the thermal relaxation, the gate error and gate length for single and 2-qubit gates, and a without error. What we're going to do is to use this noise model for one of the simulations of our algorithm, that again we repeat it 100 times as always. And what we choose is the ansatz and optimizer that are best suited to work under noisy circumstances. When it comes to the ansatz, we chose the RY ansatz with the one, as is the one that has a lower number of gates because of the parameters. And for the optimizer, the stochastic optimizer SPSA, because this stochasticity makes it to work better when noise is present. So now here we have the solution for the case of the harmonic oscillator. And we can see that as the number of qubits increases, the fidelity decreases when there is under the effect of this noise. And this is expected because as we increase the number of qubits, we increase the number of parameters and quantum gates. And as they have errors, they make the effect of noise greater than, so greater. Another reason is that as we include more quantum gates, the total duration of the circuit also increases, and this circuit is therefore more affected by decoherence, which also makes the results worse. However, it is worth pointing out that for a sufficiently small number of qubits, such as 3, we obtain a good infidelity even for the noisy case of the order of 10 to the minus 4. And this means that we can recover the theoretical wave function with a really good fidelity from noisy measurements. So for this order of the number of qubits, our algorithm has shown noise resilience. On the other hand, when it comes to the computation of the properties of the solution, we have a very significant error in the energy. As we can see, it drastically increases when noise is taken into account, and even more with the increase of the number of qubits. We can attribute it to the circuits that are used to estimate this energy. These two circuits, the one for the position space and the momentum space, are seriously affected by the gate error and cannot obtain a good approximation of this expectation value of the energy. In fact, the momentum space circuit is even more affected by noise due to the addition of the QFT. Nevertheless, we can still recover the wave function or the solution of the PD with a high fidelity, as what we do here is to affect in the same way the computation of this energy, but does not modify the optimum that we achieve. Last to finish, I would like to point out that the fact that we have such a good value of the infidelity for these three qubits points to the possibility of use error mitigation to recover the energy. And we are going to use a technique for that is called zero noise extrapolation. What we do here is to apply a certain noise model that is simple like the previous one, just with thermal relaxation, and we compute the energy for an optimized R-wise circuit with depth 1 and 3 qubits and for the harmonic oscillator for a different series of values of the noisy parameter of the thermal relaxation. This parameter is the T1, which is the time for this thermal relaxation. And what we have is that if we compute the mean over 100 measurements, each of them with 1,192 evaluations, we can see that these values admit a fifth order Taylor expansion. And we can extrapolate this to the zero noise case. Moreover, we could also use the Richardson extrapolation. And in fact, that is what we do here. And we see that for values of T1 of 50 and 100 microseconds, which are the ones of the state-of-the-art devices, we can recover this energy with a very small error of the order of 10 to the minus 2. Now, once all the results have been presented, I will draw the conclusions from this project and also talk about the future work. Well, what we have done is to develop a variational quantum algorithm that is capable of solving partial differential equations. And in order to reproduce continuous functions in a quantum register, we have to found a map between the two of them using quantum Fourier transform and also Fourier interpolation. For representing these continuous functions, new variational ansatz have been designed that are capable of reproducing this smooth, highly differentiable solution and also to embed their symmetries. Then, after that, what we have done is to analyze the performance of this algorithm under ideal and noisy circumstances. In idealized scenarios, we have obtained very good results for the fidelity. For a small number of qubits, such as 3, we can reach low infidelities of the order of 10 to the minus 5. In this case, it was for the harmonic oscillator, but again, for the transmon qubit, the result were also good, but maybe just one order of magnitude smaller. For the case of the noise sources, we have that for 3 qubits and the harmonic oscillator, we have shown a small infidelity of the order of 10 to the minus 4, allowing us to recover the theoretical resolution of the partial differential equation from the noisy measurements, what means that our algorithm is well suited for its performance in current NISQ era quantum computers. Now, let me introduce you some of the future approaches that we have thought about. The first one is to reduce the number of parameters of the ansatz because the ZGR that has shown a really good performance has an exponential scaling of the number of parameters with the number of qubits, which is costly. So what we aim is to develop an algorithm, an ansatz that is based on the same philosophy to construct the quantum circuit, but with a lower scale. Another possibility to reduce the cost of the algorithm is to choose another gradient technique that does not need for such a high number of evaluations of the cost function. Moreover, we could also extend our algorithm to another application, such as the resolution of nonlinear problems or problems in higher dimensional spaces. Finally, despite the good infidelity results obtained because of the great performance of the combination of variational methods with stochastic optimizers, we have not reached such good results when it comes to the estimation of the properties of this solution, in this case, the energy. And the reason is the limitations of the variational method itself, as we need a great number of measurements in order to obtain a good estimation of both the energy and the analytic gradient. A possibility would be to find other techniques in which this number of measurement is not so high for estimating both the gradient and the energy. But nowadays, if we want to achieve values of the error that are within the experimental requirement, which for example, for the transmon qubits is an order of 10 to the minus 4, we will have to increase this number of measurements in an order that goes from 10 to the 2 to 10 to the 5 times. And these are a lot of measurements, and this is just not feasible in the current NIST era, where we have unlimited access to these quantum computers, and not only that, but also the problem of temporal stability. In this situation, we offer a solution, and it is to use quantum-inspired methods, such as tensor networks. Using this approach, we could benefit from the encoding that we have already designed, and not only that, but also take advantage of the heuristic methods that are already developed for the sensor networks and that have shown to have a better performance when it comes in terms of the results. Now, that was the end of my presentation. I hope you have enjoyed it. If you have any questions, just feel free to ask them. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Paula, for a very beautiful talk.
Thank you.
It's open for questions if you have any.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you, too, guys. It was, now I think I understand much better what you are doing. I was wondering, you always check the error in the estimation of the sort of energy, if I understand well.
Yeah.
The average of the differential operator, but I was wondering whether this, well, I understand this is the natural figure of merit, but is this when you measure observables, because imagine you want to use your variational wave function to predict a property of the function, like the value of the function at some point or the average. So is the error the same, or is it smaller, or do you have an intuition of whether the error is less or more than what you estimate by looking at the energy?
For the observables, it's like separately instead of the addition.
Yeah, that's right. Yes, or any observable that you like I don't know, like the, because after all you are estimating a probability distribution.
Yeah.
But you want to use it for something. For some reason, so normally this is my intuition of this. So what you typically are interested in is in properties of this function rather than on the value of E.
Yeah. Yes, I mean, what we do is to just, as you said, no, we estimate the energy, but in fact, what we are doing is to separately compute the expectation values of these two operators. So this computation has its own uncertainty.
Yes.
And we are using two different, maybe we can see, yeah, here it's better, because we prepared two different circuits separately, one for the position space, another for the momentum. And we use them also in a separate manner to compute these expectation values.
Yeah, of course.
So you have the error associated to this circuit, these measurements, and the one of these circuits separately. And then you have these two random variables and you add them, and by adding them, you also have this the error of the addition of two random variables. So, yeah.
Okay, so these two things you calculated separately. So do you mean that you
We compute completely independent, like quantum series. I mean, this is the we compute this with the ansatz, the RY or the ZGR, and this is the same ansatz, but then we apply the Fourier transform to work in the Fourier space and compute the estimate for this operator.
Okay. Yeah, I was also wondering whether some other things that you may be interested in, other observables, may have even lower errors than the ones you have for B and D, but well, maybe this is something can be at some point. Okay, yeah, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Diego. Any other question? So I'm going to ask you one. So do you think that actual computers, the ones we have right now, are useful in solving partial differential equations, or do we need better ones?
Well, I said there are many different approaches, but I'm going to talk about the one I'm familiar with, the one that I presented. When it comes to the solutions, maybe nowadays it's not worth using them because of the limitation of the number of measurements. So it is not possible to use as many measurements as we want. And in fact, even though we will have so many measurements, the effect of noise, I think, is too great to achieve a fidelity that is high enough when compared with current classical methods. So maybe for these limitations, nowadays it's not possible, but in the future, if the performance of the quantum computer improves, I think that this approach is going to be very useful and is going to lead to very good results that we can see from the ideal simulations.
Thank you, Paula.
You're welcome.
Okay, let me ask one question.
Yeah, of course. Okay.
Regarding to this last question that Juanjo asked, so I understand that one of the main problems, as you said, is the noise. And then what happens is that instead of solving a differential equation without noise, the noise introduces you on some sort of stochastic term in the differential equation. And I am asking, is this complete model taking into account the noise useful for something? Because what it is going to be very good, the quantum computer, is to solve this type of stochastic problem, no?
I mean, so what do you mean? If the noise model uses a good approximation for the behavior of the function of the algorithm under these circumstances, or?
No, I mean that when you are solving the differential equation, then you were saying that there is a problem with the noise, and the noise makes your result not being as good as you expected for the differential equation that you are solving. That is right. But then imagine that instead the differential equation that you are solving, you want to solve another differential equation. It's a differential equation that you add a term that represents the noise that your quantum computer has.
Yeah, so maybe and then
your quantum computer would be very good at solving this problem. And my question is, if you have a feeling that this problem can be useful for something, the full problem.
With the stochastic noise in term.
Yes.
I think that, yes, I mean, if you were able to design a way to introduce the behavior of the noise in the equation, so you can expect how it is going to affect your results, you could improve them, but it would be difficult because of the nature of the stochastic noise and the complexity that you can find in the computer. But if you could take this into account, you will obtain a better estimation of this energy.
Okay, thank you.
Maybe another problem is that the noise in the quantum computer is not easily mapped to a noise in the partial differential equation. It doesn't act the same way. So if your noise is for instance, making your qubits go to zero, what it's doing is pushing probability towards the zero coordinate of your simulation, which you don't know what it means in practice. But yeah, it's difficult.
Yeah.
Okay, so maybe we can close it here because everybody is hungry. And thank you again, Paula. It was very nice presentation, full of information. I hope it will be useful for everybody.